I want to thank you, and I do this because you did. You allowed me that time with my family, and I appreciate that. It was good to kind of get away. I took them to Gatlinburg, which is, you know, 45 minutes from home, spent some time with my mom and dad, my family. Mom and dad got to babysit the grand dog, as they call him, my dog Drogo. So we had a good week, but it is good to be back here with you. I always get lost and get this feeling in the pit of my stomach, something's amiss, and it is, because I really do. I miss you, and I miss being with you. But it's good to be with you this morning. Glad you're here this morning as we worship, and let's worship and sing our praises to God together.
We missed you last Sunday, too.
Well, thank you.
Come set our hearts alight.
This morning, not much to say to you in the way of announcements. We want to let you know that the nominating committee, their process is complete, and they are going to be getting a report also. I don't know where the finance committee is, but I know the plan is that the reading of the first reading for the budget for the next year will be, I believe, August the 30th. Then they will skip a week, which is Labor Day weekend, and then the next weekend there will be the final reading. There is going to be, from my understanding, a business meeting at 10:45 on the 30th as a part of that reading for the first budget recommendation. And I believe what is going to be brought to the table, if you remember before the pandemic started and all this stuff was going on, we were going through the process of discussing security precautions, upgrades, things we needed to do to enhance the security in the church. And I believe there's going to be some information that will be coming out about that. Is that correct, any of the deacons?
Yeah.
Okay. So you'll want to be praying about that and that process as well. Patsy has been in the hospital. She had shoulder surgery. Patsy Johnson, and I want to keep her in prayer. Keep Danny in your prayers as he's going to the doctor Thursday to look at how they're going to do further treatments and procedures to help him out. We know that you are in our prayers. And Patsy needs to know that she is in our prayers. She's having a lot of pain and is staying at her son's house. But the surgery did go well. So be in prayer for Patsy Johnson as she goes through this time as well as all the others that you receive on our prayer list on a weekly basis. The nominating committee, yes?
We need to remember Joy Laughlin. I got word from them last night that they moved her to ICU.
Okay.
Her heart rate, I think, had elevated as high as 180. We didn't get an update this morning because they were having a change of shifts, and she didn't update me before I left.
Joy, what's her last name?
Laughlin.
Yes. Yeah, Joy Laughlin. You want to have her on your prayer list if she is not already. They have moved her to ICU, so we want to keep her in our prayers. Anybody else that we need to add to the prayer list?
And her daughter also, Beth, is going through chemo right now.
Okay, Beth is going through, Joyce's daughter Beth is going through chemo right now. Keep Bobby's brother in our prayers as well. But my thoughts, just to kind of remind you, with the nominating committee process and all the committees that are being put together and Sunday school teachers, that does not mean that we are still not involved. A lot of people say, well, I'm not serving on that committee, so I have nothing to do. Ideas, thoughts, and we'll talk a little bit about that this morning during our sermon time, but ideas, thoughts, things that you have, ways to help the church move forward, ways to help the church grow, any ideas and thoughts that you have, bring them to the table. Doesn't mean they're going to be accepted or put into action. Doesn't mean they're going to be completely rejected. But it's important that we all stay involved in the growth of our church instead of, well, I'm not serving on a committee, we sit back and just let things happen. If we are active in our church, active in the life of the church, we all have something to do. But we are involved in everything. And if your ideas, they say, oh, I don't think that's going to work, don't take it as an offense. It may be something that will come back around, and they go, oh, well, that'll work now. It may not be the time. But it's important that we are thinking and moving and progressing forward and doing what God is leading us to do. Because our mission is not here within the walls of the church. Our mission is out there, outside the walls of the church. Reaching people, spreading God's hope. Help for the helpless, hope for the hopeless. Y'all remember that as we go through and get ready to begin our new church here. Amen?
Thank you.
invite you to turn with me now in your scriptures to the book of Matthew, the 19th chapter, verses 13 and 14. Then little children were being brought to him in order that he might lay his hands on them and pray. The disciples spoke sternly to those who brought them. Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of heaven belongs." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This morning is a simple text, and it's one that we all know and all listen to so well, about children. You know, sometimes we look at children and there's still an old adage, let children be seen and not heard. Such a destructive saying. Some of the greatest bits of wisdom I have heard in the unbridled, almost unconscious response of a child to a question. And as we grow up, grow older, whatever you have chosen to do, we often become guarded, often spit out answers which resemble more of a corporate tone than the true leanings and learnings and knowings of our heart. We say things which all of our lives we have heard and we have learned and we have trusted them, but we have never examined them for the truth that is contained in them. There's a podcast, and I was talking with one of you this morning. I won't mention you, but someone had asked me about growing deeper in their understanding of Scripture, and there's a podcast called The Bible Project. And it is an incredible, for me and from my perspective, it's an incredible understanding of Scripture, and it removes some of the baggage of culture history and takes us back to the raw underbelly of what Scripture means. And I invite you to listen to it. There's also a website, thebibleproject.com, I believe is the name of it. But they have some videos and expressions that it may help you, may be a benefit to you, it may not, but it's something that I throw up to you today. But when it comes to understanding the place of children among us, while we love this and long for children to be a part of us, I don't know that we truly understand or take deeply enough the meaning of what this is leading us to. You see, the children in this scripture represent a little bit more of those that are unvalued. Within the book of Matthew, this text follows Jesus' teaching on divorce, in which Jesus implores, in which Jesus is asked by a rabbi, "Tell me about marriage. When can you divorce? When should you divorce?" Moses taught that you have to give her a certificate of divorce. And Jesus says to them, you can't really divorce for any reason. And actually and truly, divorce is not what is intended through marriage. must divorce your wife, it must be for a chaste living. A cheating, if you will. But even within that teaching, it still brings up the superiority within the biblical text of men over women. But that teaching brings back into perspective that women should be protected. That when you marry, as men in that time, in that understanding, you're protecting your wife. One who really had no value in society or culture, with little more than property. To divorce them was to lead them to not financial ruin, but the potential of death. Maybe throwing them into a position where they must seek means of living that would not be considered good within the community. So these teachings are about how we deal with people who are unvalued in society and culture. Have you ever thought or asked the question, do we as a church, in spite of our best efforts, in spite of what is known to us, in spite of what comes and is understood by our heart, have you ever thought that we stand in the way of the kingdom of God being a part of people's lives that are not here among us? Have you ever really thought that? That there are ways, in spite of all our efforts and the things that we do, to reach out to the community, to reach out to people who know nothing of Christ, who do not know the church, who do not know the good that is contained within the church. Have you ever thought that even by doing some of those things, we stand in the way of them knowing God? Have you ever thought that maybe by going on a mission trip and doing what you hope is good by helping someone, that you could be doing something that is destructive to them? We can. Sometimes our best intentions lead to awful things, and sometimes the things that we harness and hold on to lead to people not being able to see or understand or even darken the doors of the church. I mean, now the disciples are sitting there that day as these children are being brought to Jesus, which is really not uncommon for people to bring children to rabbis to be blessed. It's not an uncommon thing. But they're standing in the way for whatever reason. I think there are probably several reasons. Probably some of them say, well, okay, this is not valuable. Jesus is with us and he needs to be teaching these valuable things, and that is the important thing, because that is more important. And they're saying, nobody, no children today, no children today. Or maybe they just think it's a waste of time. Or maybe they believe, like they have before, that Jesus is simply too tired. He needs to go rest. He can't be bothered today because he's got to get out of here. He's had a heavy teaching schedule. We've been traveling, running around. And so there's no children today. No blessing. And for whatever reason that we can imagine, and the things that we have to go through scripture and study for, the reasons that sometimes the disciples use to literally keep Jesus away from people or literally manage his time. Jesus says, whatever your reason is, disciples, know. Because these children need to come to me. They have and they are as important to see them and set them, because it speaks of no teaching that he gives them. They say it is important. Jesus says it is important for me to simply touch them Don't you love the paintings that you often see of this situation where you literally see Jesus kneeling on the ground and children running up to him wanting to jump in his lap? And I often see Jesus with that big smile on his face. And we picture that in our minds there are hundreds of children running to him to be touched and loved and cared for. And they probably had no understanding whatsoever of who Jesus was, except they probably looked upon him and said, "He looks like a nice man. I know he's a rabbi. So I want to go sit with him." Being so open and welcoming to welcome that which is often unbridled, often undisciplined, into the presence of Jesus that is the kingdom of God. And sometimes as a church, we don't give that appearance. How many times have you heard somebody actually say to you, "I can't come to church because I don't have clothes to be able to come to church"? You ever heard somebody say that? It's an excuse many will give. And I know within this congregation, that makes no matter to people. What you wear, how you dress, but we've got a PR problem with that. We have to express that. So anybody out there that wants to know, we don't have a dress code here. It's come as you are. How many times have practices that we have done, things that we have done or not done, kept people away from the church? "I don't know anybody there," some people would say. Or they may know one person here and they say, "Well, I don't like that person." How many times do we have a celebration that people do not honor and it frustrates us? How many times do we find ways to keep people away? How many times do we find to say, "Hey, we don't have time to do it"? I mean, you have an incredible vacation Bible school once a year. But we say, "We don't have time to do anything but Sunday school the rest of the year." I don't think that is your heart. Don't get me wrong. And I think there is a reality with all of us that we don't have enough time to do things that we want to do with our families, with rest, with work. I understand that. But can we come together to find something else? Why couldn't the people who do VBS not do VBS that week and then another group do something else? And I don't have all the ideas. That's the important thing to remember about this. Soon, when the day comes that you call a pastor, please don't sit back and say, "Tell us what to do." Because it is up to us. And by our refusal to accept that, we stand in the way people coming to know Christ. We stand in the way of people, often people who see themselves as worthless to the church. We often affirm that belief not by our action, but by our inaction. Invite people to church. Tell them you want them to be a part of us. Do we do that enough? It doesn't have to be formal. "Hey, why don't you join us at church on Sunday? We'd love to see you. Love to come hang out with us." I always use that language. "We would love for you to come worship with us." It's not language that they use in culture and society now. "Why don't you come hang out? Come as you are,
just come and invite them and invite them over and over and over again. But sometimes we don't do it. I know one time that we had someone in a church and they had a pat answer. They had a standard for why they didn't invite people to church and why they didn't involve themselves. I found this out one time because they told me that. I said, why? I just asked them. I said, we missed you at visitation. Well, I was talking with a friend the other day, and a friend told me that they had heard this about our church. And their friend said, well, you've got problems at your church. And she said, so I'm not going to visit because I can't invite anybody to come to our church. And I told one of the deacons about it, and they said, well, you want to know the truth? That was three pastors ago when they had that conversation, and they shared that story every time for the last 20 years. I can think of all kinds of reasons at times that I am not happy with my church. I don't like the way things are going in my church. But you know what? The church is you. You love each other, don't you? I know you like being together. I've seen you worship. I've seen you eat together. I've seen you fellowship together. I've seen how you care for one another. I've seen how BJ likes to make me fatter by making cakes. I've seen how Larry and Pete come in and fellowship with me and made me feel so welcome. I see how I talk to you on Sunday mornings. I see how you send me text messages and ask me questions. I know you are good people. So if worship's a little off, or the sermon's a little off, or this is a little off, it doesn't matter, because you're inviting people to come and be a part of a community. And if you don't do that, you're standing in the way. And we cannot, should not be a hindrance. Not to children. Not to wives, not to brothers, not to sisters, not to the poor, not to the downtrodden, not to the homeless, not to the alcoholic, not to the drug abuser. Not to the dirty. Not to those who have different ethnic origins and cultures than us. Let them all come. Open our arms wide. Kneel down before them and welcome them. For if we don't, we are at peril because we have stood in the way of Christ's blessing upon them. And if we do that, as another understanding or reading of this text in the Gospels say, it would be better for us to have a millstone tied around our neck. And one of the things that I realized today is that these are just words. And the truth and honesty that I'm going to convey to you and tell you is it's hard. Because I know what my heart says and I know what my heart tells me. But we live in a world with realities, and sometimes we don't feel safe. And I understand that. And sometimes we don't feel comfortable. And I understand that. And that's where we as a church have to pray for conviction, courage, and passion. And that will outweigh our unsureness, our doubt, our fear, that we'll be given the wisdom to discern.
discern and understand and know. But most importantly, that we would be given a heart of compassion so that we can willingly and openly accept those who, honestly, it's in our nature sometimes to not accept. To accept those that sometimes it's in our nature to judge and proclaim against, and instead invite them into a community that offers grace and love and hope. It's hard. And so I offer you that grace from Christ to know that we all have that. But with the radical nature of the gospel that Jesus Christ brought, that Jesus Christ taught to us all, the one that lives on is he told us to open our arms wide and let them come. And it doesn't take a big mass evangelism program or a big visitation program to go out and do it, because we can do it at grocery stores and supermarkets and around the town. When we're able to get back and meet together, we can do it in community events. We can do it at town meetings. We can do it in casual relationships. And maybe in our passion, we can learn to walk up to the strangers and people we don't know and say, "You go to church? Come join us." Maybe we can do it in our work as people come in. We can say, "You want a community to hang out with? Community of faith, community that'll love you. Why don't you come to church?" And when we get back together, in truth, the number one thing that you have going on to invite people to, that's your Wednesday night family or supper. Not only does it provide great fellowship, but it's if people will not come to your church because of their food, I don't know what's wrong with them. Because that's where you're going to meet people and be able to sit and talk with them. Because the church doesn't center around just worship on Sunday morning. And the church doesn't exist for just Sunday morning. The church exists because you exist 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And the church exists so we can relate to each other and love each other. Not with one person standing up here and talking for 30 minutes. But where we have one-on-one relationships and communication with each other. And you do that every single day. That's where we worship. That's where we are, your church, O God. Amen.
us to pray for his granddaughter, Meredith Ray, who will be coming home soon. And when she does, she's going to be in quarantine for 14 days. And he wants us to pray for her and her travels. And she's in quarantine, so we'll remember to do that. But let's also remember to pray for those we mentioned this morning, but pray for one another and pray for our church. Pray for our passion and our commitment to reaching out to a world that is lost. Opening our doors and our arms and be open to explain as many times as we have to and not lose patience that we are open to all and that God has a plan for them. And we hope that they will find that plan right here at First Baptist Church in St. Paul. Will you join me this morning as we pray our benediction? God of great grace and God of mercy, you show us the way. Father, there are times in which that we don't travel that road so easily. For there are our own doubts, our fears. God, we know that your Spirit can overcome them, but we know that it is our acceptance of your power in our lives that we will come to travel that road, trusting, knowing, presenting hope to all and love to all, no matter how they are seen by this world. Father, in your eyes, they are loved. May we go knowing that we leave this place taking that love to the world, which you have so freely shown us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.